you all for being here. This is a terrific audience, and thank you, Ethelbert, for being here. I sat down with Ethelbert to talk about this introduction, and he took one look at this paper that I printed out directly from his website, and he said, "This is old, this isn't what I'm doing anymore." But as you can see, it's a full 2 pages of activities that he has done in the past. I don't think he really needs much of an introduction. You may recognize his voice when he starts speaking from his appearances on the radio. He has his show On the Margin on WPFW and appears regularly as well on WAMU. I asked him how he would like to be introduced and what he was most proud of, and we started talking about this stamp project that he participated in. And let's see, what year was it? 1997, where he got to select 12 African American writers to put on postage stamps that were issued by Ghana and Uganda. And as we were talking, it became clear that one of the reasons that this was one of the more important projects was because he got to work with people and have conversations. And I think that that's really what drives the work and drives the community and what brings us all here tonight. And so from there we started talking about baby names. We got lots of advice and lots of names of people that I absolutely need to connect with. And so I think I'm just gonna let Ethelbert do his thing and connect with all of us. And I encourage you to stick around and join the conversation after he's done. So thank you.
Thank you very much. I mentioned this as a writer. One of the most difficult things I've ever had to do was name my children. You know, they can't walk around being untitled. You know? And I say that because you name a child, and sometimes what happens, the street gives your child another name, a nickname that sticks. Or what happens, you give your child a name, and over the course of growing up, the name gets shortened into, you know, abbreviation sort of thing. So the name is very important. I mentioned this in terms of a writer right now that I sort of mentored, who's well known now. Dwayne Betts, Hunter Wayne Betts. Not familiar with him, you might want to look him up after I said his name. He was arrested here in Virginia for carjacking. He does not drive. But he went to jail for 8 years, and while he was in jail, he was writing. And he sent poems to Portlaw Magazine, which is a magazine that I edit. Portlaw Magazine is the oldest poetry magazine in the United States. It was a magazine that Walt Whitman advertised in. It was created in 1889. Dwayne sent poems to Portlaw Magazine. We accepted it, and he wrote this in his memoir. He ran around the prison excited, because what happened is that he was able to do something. And other inmates said, "Wow, you know, we feel happy for you, you know." So you never realize how important it is. But here is Dwayne this year, I think, putting out his 4th book. And he wants to change his name. See, he's Reginald, it's R. Dwayne Betts. Okay? He wants to use that Reginald because that's his father's name. And he had a hard time working out his relationship with his father. And he will tell you, "Ethelbert, thank you for encouraging me to always say, I love you, my father." And for him to reach a point now, he's battling with his publisher. Because, you know, you change your name on the book. It's like, okay, what do the librarians do? You know what I'm saying? And I say that in terms of the name is so important. Early today, I came to this exhibit. I don't know Radcliffe Bailey, but I did some research. We have a number of friends in common. And I think that after this presentation, I'm going to definitely reach out and talk to him, because he loves something that I love. I found out from doing his research that he loves baseball. And so the last poems that I'll be reading tonight will be baseball poems, and I'll dedicate those to Radcliffe. But when I came in here, you know, this afternoon to get a feel for this exhibit, I knew just as I walked in that my work connected. Because as an African-American writer, slavery has always been very important to me as something to write about. I don't feel being trapped by being an African-American writer. I feel that blackness is something that I need to always celebrate. I feel that the experience of slavery is an extremely important human message that we can always go back and learn something about. And it's something that when we look at it from various different perspectives, and that's sort of still being told, so much can be learned from it. Let me give you an example of a poem to show you what I've done with slavery. This was a poem I was going to read last, but I'm going to read it first so you can see exactly where I wound up. This is called Slave Narratives. I slip indoors after searching for hours for the North Star. Rumors have been spreading about how a fabulous day is a night with no moon. The problem with plantations is that the pizza driver never comes. Just yesterday, my copy of Ebony was delivered to the big house. Massa had a fit. Now I'll have to hide my Coltrane and Miles records under the big quilt. I hear slavery is hard on the eyes, but a beautiful woman can teach you to read in the dark. Now you can see, I put Miles in there. I put Ebony magazine in there. I'm using slavery in such a way that I'm inverting certain things within it, and I'll talk about that in terms of my presentation. But when I walked in the door, I saw Radcliffe dealing with slavery, the swamp, and the maroons. There's a writer by the name of Nubia Kai who has a novel called I Spread My Wings and I Fly. She lives here in the area. I interviewed her on my show last year, and I learned a lot from Nubia's novel because when someone said the maroons, I immediately always thought of Jamaica. I always thought of the maroons in terms of the slaves that came to Jamaica and ran into the hills, were difficult to capture, and build their own communities. So that was the maroon in my head. And then also from studying African American literature and history, I always knew about Marcus Garvey, okay, who was very popular during the 1920s because it's back to Africa movement with the UNIA. And Garvey took pride he was dark skinned and that he could trace his family back to the maroon. So as a young person, that word maroon was linked to Jamaica and linked to Garvey. But when I was reading Nubia Kai's novel to interview her, she was introducing me to the maroons as a concept in other geographical areas. In her novel, it's Louisiana, where the slaves ran into the swamps. There's other parts of maroons in Florida, okay? And this is why you see this such a wonderful experience that you can continue to go back and tap, okay? And this is why, whether it's Nubia Kai or myself or Radcliffe, this way you can always go back and bring stories to the forefront to get us a better understanding. Okay, so we can see now that when we think about slavery, if we think about it in terms of geography, it changes, okay, based on landscape, okay, and it's based also in terms of what is being grown in a particular state, okay. If you go into some classroom and you talk about slavery, somebody always thinks that everybody's picking cotton, right? When you deal with Nubia Kai's novel, it's sugarcane, okay? And when you deal with the different types of tobacco, things of that sort, the type of labor varies. It becomes extremely strenuous, okay, in terms of how this gets to the market. And so when I look at the whole thing with rooms, I immediately thought about that. Then being here this afternoon, I looked at the whole thing in terms of what I was invited to do, and that was to come and try to take my work and connect it to this exhibit. Now, I'm not writing ekphrastic poems in terms of I didn't look at Radcliffe's work and then wrote a poem, but I have been doing that with other artists. So I'll read two poems from this new book called Bearden's Odyssey, Romare Bearden, right? And this is a book consisting of 35 African-American poets. There's 49 poems in here. And what we were invited to do by the editor, Kwame Doors, is to look at these paintings by Romare Bearden and write poems. Now, this happens to me all the time. The paintings that they showed me, and I wrote the poems for, are not the paintings that are included in the book. But they like my poems, so they included the poems, but it's like, you know, where's the photograph, right? And as you can see, this is a very beautiful book. The artwork folds out like this, okay? So if they had included the illustrations that I was working with, you could see it, but you just have to hear the words. But this book is a beautiful book. It has a foreword by Derek Walcott, the Nobel Prize winner who just recently passed away this year. If you're familiar with Romare Bearden's work, you can always go back to it. One of the things I chuckle about over the last several years, so many African-American books in terms of literature, history, either had a Romare Bearden or a Jacob Lawrence print on the cover, one of those two artists. But here are the two poems that I wrote. One is a Romare Bearden picture of Harriet Tubman with a gun, and I wrote this poem called Tubman. And I have an epigraph from the poet Mary Baraka. Arm yourself or harm yourself. Short woman with a gun, leading me through woods, footprints left beside rivers. Freedom is a powerful thing. Sometimes you have to hold it in your hands and listen for the click. I'll read that again. Short woman with a gun, leading me through woods, footprints left beside rivers. Freedom is a powerful thing. Sometimes you have to hold it in your hands and listen for the click. The second poem is Conjure Woman. I was always into this thing about when I was growing up, you know, my mother would tell me these things. If you go out, don't let any white person touch your hair. That's homework. You haven't heard that, that's homework, okay? But what happened is it was a whole thing where somebody, when we were small, we would be at the supermarket and we would sometimes carry the groceries to an older person's house to help them out. And sometimes a white person would say, oh, I don't need any help, and they rub her head. And someone said, if you rub a person's head for good luck, okay? Oh, and my mother said, don't let anybody touch your head. You know, we grow up on that. I said, oh, I don't care, I didn't know about that. And I was talking to a group like this in Salt Lake City, right? And I said this, and the guy who escorted me to the church was white, because it's a small black church in Salt Lake City. And he was like, what are you talking about? We go back to the writer's conference where I was the writer for sitting in this conference, and I come in, and somebody says, Ethra, how did it go?
Oh, jeez.
He's still laughing, you know? Oh, so that's not made up. Somebody, you know, they rub their head, how'd it go? Anyway, Conjure Woman. She laughs with the birds before she talks to me. Heartbreak loving brought me to these woods. Yes, I'm sick and can't think right. You know I did wrong. Every man has to find his road before his creek rides. This woman knows you chase the sun and follow the moon. She knows the world is black and white and filled with fools. Conjure Woman cures my eyes before I see the blues. It's Conjure Woman. Now I'm going to read poems dealing with slavery that come from this collection, my collected poems that came out last year. And I think you'll get a flow of how I deal with the Middle Passage, I deal with slavery, I'll bring in some individuals who you probably know, and you'll see how all these poems work together. And I'm only reading them this way because of this exhibit, okay? So these are poems that I probably never have read as a body of poems. But because it's exhibit, this is, you can see how it affected me in terms of my own work. And so thank you, Radcliffe. This is called Tomorrow. Tomorrow, I will take the journey back. Sail the Middle Passage. It would be better to be packed like spoons again than to continue to live among knives and forks. I'll read that again. These are short poems. Tomorrow. Tomorrow I will take the journey back, sail the Middle Passage. It would be better to be packed like spoons again than to continue to live among knives and forks. In this short poem, you can teach African American history. One of the things, if you're a teacher, what you would have to do to the class, with the class, you would have to place a picture, illustration, of how the slaves were packed into the ships, okay? And you know that what they were packed very tight because the people owning the ships expect they're going to lose X number of slaves before they get to the new world. So you build that loss in. Okay? And this is why somebody said the shark was just following those boats because people were sick or would die, they're thrown over. But you expect to lose, so you pack everyone in like spoons. Okay? There's an excellent children's book, or actually for adults also, by the artist Tom Feeling, where he gives this illustration of the middle passage, and it's powerful. But what I want to do is begin with that, being packed by spoons, it says, then to continue to live among knives and forks. Now, let's bring that up to the Trump administration. What happens now is that you can raise a question in terms of how safe is our country, okay? You know, when we look at blue and our red state, when we look at the town meetings and stuff, there is a certain degree of violence. You know, we've just seen this locally, okay? You could almost say, well, you know, do you want to live among knives and forks, those utensils that seem to just be cutting and slicing and stuff like that and prodding people? Maybe we just go back and be spoons. Be packed that way as opposed to every day waking up and being terrorized. Okay? So this is just a short poem, okay, in which you see me drawing upon ordinary objects. Now, if I went in the kitchen, there's a lot of other things in there. Can openers and other things, but you would have to write your own poems on how a can opener fits into American history, and that can depend on whatever ethnic group you are. But you can see right here that you can draw upon things that are around you to interpret your history or get a better grasp of it. So that's one poem. Let me read you this one. This is called Anna Murray Douglas. Anna Murray Douglas. This is Douglas's first wife, Frederick Douglas's first wife. I cannot read the North Star, but it shines at night in my bedroom. I hold a free man in my arms. Is it love that still keeps me a slave? What speech could he whisper in my ears that would make me listen to his heart? In the dark, does my dark skin remind him of the darkness? I cannot spell the word abolitionist. I can only read the name Frederick Douglass. I know these two words well. Many will remember the life he lived, and me, yes, they will say, I was his wife before he married the white woman. And I just look at that in terms of how, I was always fascinated by, here is Frederick Douglass, who's one of the most photographed individuals. You know, there's a book that came out just on how many times and how Frederick Douglass was photographed. But I was amazed by the fact that his first wife couldn't read. And you know that when we learn about Frederick Douglass, especially Frederick Douglass' narrative, just the whole thing of learning how to read is